Welcome back to Cricket Aviation. My name is Jim Payne, and in this video, we are going to go over the elevator control system on the CriCri. Now, if you start watching this video, you might want to watch it all the way through to the end because I get about 3/4 of the way through this video and I complete the video. I've got all of the flight controls completed for the elevator system. Everything looks like it's great, and I say thank you for watching. Well, you'll find out that's actually not the end of the video because later, after I got all the flight controls done, I went back and started doing some of the rigging on the elevator system and the stick itself. I started checking the angles on the stops for the stick travel. I started looking at the stick neutral position as it relates to the elevator trim system, and I found some problems. And so in the last quarter of this video, I go back and fix those issues. But what I want to do right now in the beginning of this video is I want to take the camera over here and we're going to look at the elevator system in detail, and I am going to go over all the issues that I found during the rigging process that then you can watch for in the beginning of the video to see where I made mistakes. But anyway, let me grab the camera. Let's take a closer look at the elevator system on the CriCri. So the parts that we're going to go over in this video is actually installing this cross tube assembly that connects the stick to the elevator control system. Now, I did not weld up this tube assembly here. John actually did this for me, and I really appreciate it because it actually turned out really nice. But there are some issues that I ran into that I think we need to discuss. So the other thing we're going to do also here is this, I guess it's an octopus assembly, they call it. You'll see in the video, I hate this bracket. I'm not sure how I can actually include this in a kit because of how complicated it is to bend and to make sure that you get the centering point here where this tube attaches to the right distance from frame 4 and the right distance up from the floor. And of course, all of that is based on where you actually installed this bearing bracket that goes on the side of the fuselage that we installed a long time ago when we were working on the forward fuselage here. So again, you'll see that in the video also. But the issues that I ran into when I tried to start doing the rigging, and actually let me go through the actual controls here first. So we've got the trim lever here, and we've got the arm here that connects to the stick assembly, and then we've got the push rod that connects back to the horizontal stabilizer. Now the problems I ran into is that the stick itself here is supposed to be positioned in its neutral point 5 degrees forward of vertical, or 90 degrees from the horizontal center position of the fuselage. Now what I was using is the front part of frame 4 kind of as my reference because I know frame 4 was installed perpendicular to the horizontal plane of the airplane. And so the stick is supposed to be 5 degrees forward of this vertical position of frame 4. The problem is this this 5 degrees forward is determined by the trim setup. And the trim setup has to be made exactly centered so that when you get 5 degrees forward position on the stick, that you're in your neutral position for the trim system. So the issues I had with the trim system were compounding issues. And what happened here is that when I installed the trim lever, I did not pay close attention to the measurement that's in the plans between this front bolt connection here on frame 4, which is actually where we drill out a rivet in frame 4 and install a bolt. But there's a measurement from this bolt to the center of the lever arm here for the trim system. And I wasn't too concerned about it because I thought all of this was adjustable. You know, we have this adjustment here, but that has nothing to do with the centering position of the stick or the centering position of the trim or where you hit the stops, which is all controlled by how you build this, not by how you adjust it. So what I ended up doing is my position of this trim lever ended up being 4 millimeters aft of where it should have been. Now, part of the reason I did that was there was two different reasons. One is that my frame 4 is a little bit wider than what is specified in the plans, and there is no exact measurement of how wide frame 4 should be, and some of it is depend on the angles that are in the spar box that we used. You know, we use 16th inch angles instead of 1 millimeter angles, and all that kind of adds to the width of the spar box. So you can have a little bit wider spar box or a little bit narrower depending on what angles are in the spar box itself. So it wasn't an error or anything I did wrong with frame 4, it was just ended up being a little bit wider on the wider side because of the thicker angles. So what I ended up doing is I made this bracket in the back, basically according to the plans, but modified its width to match mine. And then these are two other bolt holes that we end up drilling, or rivet holes that we end up drilling out to attach that to on the backside. But this bolt that comes out here that this lever attaches to is supposed to be welded to a little triangle piece that mounts to this triangle piece in the back here, this aluminum mount. And what I did is I slid that steel mount as far forward as I could until the tips and the bottom of it started coming off of this plate in the back, and that's where I decided I was going to put the trim lever. But again, it ended up being 4 millimeters after where it should have been based on this measurement here. So what that does though is, because I had this 4 millimeters further aft, it increased the distance from this arm to the trim lever, but didn't increase the distance from frame three, where the mount is for these rubber bands, to the center of this pivot point for the basically the elevator system, or the elevator control rod connection. So that caused an issue where I had at its centering point here, more distance here, less distance here, which wanted to pull the stick further aft, which wasn't good to begin with. But then I had a secondary issue where the bracket here that was welded onto this tube was not welded on at exactly parallel with where the stick ended up coming out of this assembly. Now, it's kind of difficult to determine when you're welding these parts on this tube assembly here where the stick is going to end up, you know, a little bit forward or backward, because it's based off where the holes are drilled through here, where you attach the bottom half of the stick. There's a lot of variables there. But the end result was, is where the stick ended up being about 3 degrees aft of where this bracket was attached. So not only did I have the trim lever assembly too far aft, but I also had a 3 degree forward tilt of this lever arm that was farther forward than the stick. So when the stick was at 5 degrees, the lever arm here was actually at 8 degrees, which even reduced the distance here between this bracket and the trim lever, or and the elevator control arm here, and the control arm and the trim. So what ended up happening is, once I started rigging the system to get 5 degrees forward on the stick at its neutral position, I had to move the trim lever all the way forward. So I basically had no nose down trim available at the neutral position of the stick. So what I ended up having to do is, I had to make this new aluminum plate back here so that a little bit bigger, so that I could get this position of this mount for the trim lever moved forward to its proper measurement from this nut or this bolt here to the center. That fixed that problem. But what I also had to do was make a new control arm here that had the bolt attachment holes offset 3 degrees to tilt that backwards so that it was perfectly parallel with the stick, which allowed me to get the stick at 5 degrees at its neutral position and get the trim lever at its neutral position to center that stick at 5 degrees. So I wasn't really concerned about how all of this was going to work out, because again, I thought it was adjustable, but it's actually not. Now, at that 5 degrees stick forward position, you're supposed to be able to pull back on the stick 25 degrees and you should hit the stop, which is actually supposed to be at the front of the seat here. And mine ends up being at the front of the seat and at the front of frame four, where it hits the seatbelt bracket. And that seems to be perfectly set at 25 degrees. The stop forward is supposed to be 23 degrees, where this nut and bolt here coming out of the stick attachment is supposed to hit a stop that's on the fuel tank. And this is where I ran into some issues with the fuel tank, because I ended up hitting down here at the fuel tank as I pushed this forward long before I ever hit a stop here. So I kept having to try and move the fuel tank further forward in the fuselage, and I ended up having to get to the point where it was sitting up on top of frame two and not really between frame two and frame three like it should have been. I was having to tilt it up in order to get this stick system to not hit before it hit possibly the stop that could be attached to the front of the fuel tank. Now, I probably could have gone back and started to grind down on this to make this, you know, reduce this so I didn't hit the tank, but the fact is I had other fit issues with the tank also. It was hitting the cables on either side, and the fit just wasn't good, so that's why we're kind of starting over with a new fuel tank mold. But again, I just wanted to comment on the issues that I had here. Now, these rubber bands here are just temporary, just to kind of, you know, test the system out. I have to put new rubber bands in there, and they have to be bound around the ends here because they will start to want to fall out or pop out of those holes if they're not really secured and wrapped around on either side, like they show on the plans. But these rubber bands not only provide the centering position for the trim, as you push the trim forward and backward, it pulls the center part of the stick, but it also acts as an artificial feel system for the elevator controls. So because this airplane is so small, the controls could be extremely light, and so this actually adds some artificial feel as you pull and pull, push and pull on the stick, which is a really, really neat setup because it'll effectively, you know, limit your amount of over control that you end up doing on the airplane because this control, you know, the controls themselves are not quite so sensitive. So this is adjustable then as far as how much pressure you want to actually have on the system when you're flying. So again, I just want to point these things out. I do fix these all in the end of the video and you'll see that. And again, it's something I didn't catch when I was actually building the elevator controls, but it is something that I figured out once I started to do the actual rigging. And so if you're going to be building this from plans or something, I would definitely watch out for the measurements, which are critical here, and the angles here, which are critical with the stick as you're actually building it. Not only paying attention to that when you're welding this tube assembly here, is to make sure that you try and get that as accurate as possible with where the theoretical position of the stick should be and the mount of the elevator control arm there. So anyway, so let's get on with the video. Again, appreciate you watching the video. Please like the video and subscribe to the channel if you're not already a subscriber. And let's start getting into the video and we'll start assembling the elevator control system. I started to work on the elevator assembly. This is what's called the transverse elevator assembly that goes in the front of the airplane that the stick actually connects to. And I've got a lot of things I have to do to this. Now, John actually welded this for me, just per the plans. He also welded the lower stick connection here per the plans. And the only thing I've done on this so far is that there is a bushing that needed to be installed inside of this tube. So this is a really thin tube, and inside of here is a 1/4 inch to 1/8 inch steel bushing, and I just used some 3/8 outer diameter, 1/4 inch inner diameter 4130 tubing, and I just cut down the outside of it on a lathe so that it fit inside of here, and then I drilled out the inside of it to fit a 1/4 inch bolt, and I've got a 1/4 inch bolt going through here, and this the fit turned out really nice here. So the stick is going to attach to here, and then we've got a bunch of other parts that need to be installed on this. So this is the actual elevator connection. So what happens is this has to have holes drilled into it. This gets bolted basically to here. There's a bearing that goes in here that connects to the push rod that goes to the elevator. And then up at the top here, I've got to cut this out and clean out this part. But there's some basically rubber bands that go from this inside the airplane that provide some ability for trim. So there's a trim lever that connects to this, and with rubber bands it can put pressure to pull this tube either back or forward in the airplane to kind of help trim the airplane out. So I'm going to work on cleaning this up, get the bearing installed in here, and get this aladined. Let's see, the bottom of the stick here connects to this. And this has to have two bearings in it, and these go to the push rods for the ailerons. But what I've got to do with this is I've got to clean this up a little bit. I actually have to put two 15 degree bends in this because there's supposed to be a bend here and a bend here. So these bearings are supposed to be kind of angled back towards the rear of the airplane. So I'm going to clean this up, try and get these bends in here. I'm just going to put it in my vise and just bend it right across here on either side. We'll get the bearings installed in this and get this aladined, and then we can rivet this to the bottom of the stick here. I'll probably have to clean all this metal up here and get this painted so that we don't have any further rusting issues. But that's basically what I'm working on right now, is just trying to get this assembly right here ready to be installed in the airplane. So I'm gonna go clean up some of these parts and I'll show you what it looks like when I get a little bit further. So one of the first things that we need to do to get the elevator controls installed in the airplane is to install this steel stick mount here. Now, John welded this up for me, so it should be, you know, for the most part, ready to go. This is where we bolt in the arm here that connects to the stick that all of the push rods connect to through this bearing. So this gets bolted into here. The push rods get, you know, attached to here. And then inside the airplane, this goes back and forth and does the elevator controls. Now what we have to do is we've got a bearing installed on the side of the fuselage that we did a long time ago when we were building the forward fuselage that is supposed to go on the end of this stick here. But on the other end here, this has to be supported inside the airplane because this goes in the airplane similar to this. The stick goes in the center here. And what we have to do is make a bracket that attaches to the end of this that also attaches to the top and the bottom of frame 4. And that's what this strange looking bracket here is. So I cut this out on my CNC machine. One end of this is supposed to connect to the top of frame 4, the other end is supposed to connect to the bottom of frame 4. And what we have to do is do two 90 degree bends in this to get this folded over to attach to the side here and have it bent over in the top and bottom to connect to frame 4. This is kind of a very strange bend, and it's going to be interesting to see how this goes. I am going to anneal this with, you know, by heating it and putting the Sharpie on there until the Sharpie starts to disappear, and quench it so that I can hopefully soften this and bend this. This is 1/8 inch material, so it is going to be a little bit difficult to bend. But I went ahead and cut this at, I think it's around 82 degrees. But this is what we're kind of going to have to use to mark and bend this. But what we have to do is if I place this right about here, that's about where we need to bend this. So I need a 90 degree bend up this direction and a 90 degree bend up this direction. Then we bend the ends of this to flatten it out to get it to attach to frame 4. But I have to do two major bends here with actually very little material to grab onto. If you look, it's actually a tapered bend along here off the end of here, a tapered bend here off the end of here. And I got to figure out how to clamp this in a vise and get it to bend without these fingers wanting to pull out while I try and bend it. So I have no idea how this is going to go. In the manual, it does mention to cut out the fingers afterwards, and I can kind of understand why, because it would be a lot easier to bend this if this was just kind of one rectangular piece. Because again, I wouldn't have to worry about these fingers wanting to pull out of the vise when I bend it. And I may end up creating another one of these if I have that problem, but because I have the CNC machine, I certainly didn't want to have to cut this out by hand after I bent it. So I thought I'd just cut it out first and then bend it and see how it goes. If it doesn't work out, I'll make another one. But this is what I'm going to work on next. I'm going to try and get this bent, and I'll show you what it looks like when I'm done, and we'll see how the first one turns out here. All right, well, we're on to now try number 2. So I did try and bend this. It did not work at all. The problem is you cannot get a good enough grip on this finger here to be able to bend this this thinner part, which I kind of knew that when it started. I just thought, well, I'm going to give this a try and see how hard it is. Even though I annealed this, this is really, really hard. It's a lot harder to bend than I expected it to be. So what I did here is I cut out another piece, and as the manual suggests, I haven't completely cut out the fingers. In fact, this is only a thousandth of an inch or so, or a couple thousandths of an inch mark that I did with the CNC machine as it went around, just so I could tell exactly where I needed to cut these out after it's bent. That was one of my issues. Either I had to, you know, print off a copy of the part and, you know, glue it on here or on a piece of paper with the marks on it so I could do it afterwards, but this is going to get completely beaten up trying to just bend it. So this was the easiest way for me on the CNC machine, was to just kind of put a light mark in it with the router bit. So, and I also marked the holes and everything, so this should be good to go. I am going to go in and try and bend this again and see how it works out. I'm just going to clamp it in there like I did before, and I can pretty much just align this close to here. Now, I did put a line on this right down the center of this angle so I can make sure that this hole in the center was lining up, because that's the other thing that's difficult to tell, is how to line this piece up and that you're not off, or, you know, have the hole over here or something when you're doing it instead of over there where it needs to be. So I'm gonna go ahead and try bend number 2 here, and we'll see how this one works out. I'll show you what it looks like when I get done. Hopefully this one does a little bit better than the first try. Well, this second try worked out pretty good, right until I cracked it. Even though I heat treated it, and I just hit it a little bit too hard, and I might have to radius my form a little bit more The bend was looking pretty good on the inside, but it's definitely a little bit too tight. And so I cracked the second one, so we're gonna cut out, see if we can cut out another one. This is one of those parts where, honestly, I don't know how to include this in a kit. This part is there's no other easy way to make this except by hand, and making it by hand is not easy. You know, even after I get it bent, I've got to come back and try and cut out all these areas where the fingers are, and I get that this might be the lightest and strongest way to make a bracket for the end of the control stick. This is one place where I'd almost like to come up with a different solution than this, because this is, it's pretty bad when I got to do it two times, now three times, to even get one that's going to work, and likely the third time might not work either. So I can't obviously include a part like that in a kit that either I have to make by hand after several tries or more than one try, or I have to send this out to somebody who can bend something like this in some kind of die, but then there's a huge expense in getting a form made. So I'm not exactly sure how I'm gonna include this in a kit, but I'll keep working on it until I get one made for me, and then I'll kind of go from there. Well, I think I was successful in getting the shape on the third try. What I did is I did have to put much bigger radiuses than I initially had on my little form here that I used to shape this in the vise. Also, this form and the part want to move around when you're pounding on it, so I constantly had to take this out of the vise, readjust this, put this back in the vise, pound on it a little bit more, take it out, readjust it. So it was kind of a process. I have a lot of tool marks in here, but they should come out actually with just some light sanding. The good thing is that it's pretty much square when I lay it down. All four corners are touching except for this one, but this leg is bent up just a little bit. It's not quite straight. So I think I can fix that. So now what I think I'm going to do is try and cut this out. The other thing I did too, let me mention this, I did anneal this twice. So with each one of these bends, I bent it probably 80% of the way, but then that last 20% gets really, really hard to bend. So what I did is I put Sharpie on it again right here at the bend where I was bending it on both sides. I heated it on both sides, quenched it again, and then bent it the rest of the way. Normally I wouldn't do that. I'm not sure, you know, as far as part strength, this thing is so strong, I can't imagine that I'd have any issues with this, you know, in the airplane. So I'm not worried about it. It seems to be way stronger than it needs to be anyway. So let me see if I can clean this up and get these fingers cut out here. I'm gonna see if I can do that on my lathe. I'm not even sure how I'm gonna do that because I don't have a bandsaw, but I'll figure that one out. And I'll show you what it looks like when I get it a little bit cleaned up. Well, I got all the initial cleanup done on this bracket. It actually cleaned up really nicely, so I'm pretty happy with what it looks like. Now, some of you may be saying, well, why did you spend all the time cleaning it up when you haven't bent the ends of it and you haven't even figured out if it fits in the airplane yet? And that would be a legitimate question. But what I can tell you is I'm not making another one. So it's going to fit one way or another. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start at the bottom here and I'm going to bend these ends over and see if I can get this fit in the airplane like this on top of frame 4. And do a couple preliminary measurements from the fuselage bottom up to this hole just to see how close I am. From what I could tell, it looked like it needs to be about 72 millimeters from where the bottom of these flanges are bent to that hole. Seems about right compared to where my bearing is right now in the airplane. But we're going to bend from the top up. I think that's the best way to go. So I am going to heat treat the ends of these real quick. And then go ahead and bend them, and we'll start doing some test fitting. So I bent the fingers on the ends of this bracket here, and I've started to do some preliminary measurements and fit check here. What I ended up doing is I marked on the bottom fingers here about 13 millimeters from the edge, stuck it in the vise, bent the legs together. And I did anneal those just to make sure that I wouldn't have any cracking issues and they'd bend a little bit easier. The top ones I bent at about 12 millimeters. And you can see I squared off the bottom bracket fingers similar to what they show in the plans. And part of the reason for that is once I fit this in here like this, I did measure from this hole back to frame 4, and then I measured from the center of the bearing hole over here back to frame 4, taking into account the fact that this does have a 20,000ths piece on top of here, on top of frame four compared to that measurement. So I took that into account, and when I first put this in here, this hole that's in the front here that needs to line up with that bearing across there was about 3 millimeters further forward than it should have been, and it's about a millimeter too high. But that was before I squared off the ends of these fingers on the bottom, and now it's really close. So it's probably about a millimeter too far out. I'm measuring about 45 millimeters when I should be about 44, and it's measuring just a little bit high at about 81 millimeters compared to the bearing, which is about 80. Now, I also don't have this bolted in, and when I bolt it in, it's probably gonna suck down just a little bit because I don't think these fingers are perfectly flat on the bottom and top of frame four, and the bolts will kind of squish those down together. So I'm expecting it to move down a little bit. And then as far as it sticking out a little bit further, again, it's so close, I'm not sure it really matters. And again, I could adjust the location of this hole and just move it over or down slightly to make it closer. But I mean, we're talking about fractions of a millimeter at that point. I also put that steel tube in here to measure across here. And it's really close. It's really hard to tell. Just estimating it, I stuck it in the bearing hole and I just swung it over here to see, and it's right in there. So I'm assuming it should be good if I just, use the holes that I marked in here and the holes that I marked in the bracket and drill that. But I am going to do a little bit more fit. In fact, I'm trying to figure out if I should drill that bearing hole or the bearing support hole there first. Put the rod, put the steel tube in this end, bolt it to the end of the steel tube on this end, swing it in, and then drill it. Or maybe I drill it and then final drill it with that. I'm not exactly sure what I'm going to do. I'm going to have to play with it a little bit. The other thing I haven't really figured out is it appears that the tube that goes across here that has the threaded end on it, it looks like that side of that tube is supposed to just ride on this aluminum part. There's nothing in the plans that shows there's anything in between it. Now, I do have some welding stuff on the end of there. In fact, let me grab the tube here. Hold on. Yeah, so here's the tube. So I do have some of the weld that went around the outside here that I'm gonna have to take off because this surface needs to be obviously quite smooth. We don't want any wear between the end of this tube and that aluminum just because it's rocking back and forth. The other end here isn't really a concern because we've got the steel bearing on there that's going to hit the surface in the center closest to the actual threaded pin. It's not gonna be touching the outside edges, so it's not a concern on that side. But I am going to try and clean up the end of this, and like I said, I think what I'm going to do is probably just final drill that hole, attach, go ahead and attach that to the end of here, stick the tube in here, and then swing it into place when I actually drill it, just to make sure there's no extra tension one way or another or gap in between here, which we don't want. So that's what I'm going to work on next, is just trying to, keep fitting this in here and keep fitting that in there and see if I can get the actual bolt holes drilled or initial drilled so I can start making sure this is actually going to fit in the end. So let me start working on a few more things and I'll show you what it looks like when I get a little bit further here. So I cleaned up the weld on the end of the tube here. So that's nice and smooth. That should work out all right. Before I go any further though, I was going to drill this hole out, but then I realized there is a 1/8 inch doubler that needs to go on the inside of this bracket that needs to be installed with 3 countersunk rivets on both sides. So I'm going to go ahead and try and make this piece that goes in here, this doubler, and go ahead and get the holes drilled into that. I want to get that riveted in before I drill this hole out any further, so that I make sure that I drill those out at the same time. And ream those together at the same time. So I'm going to go ahead and cut that piece out. I think what I'm going to do is just make that piece by hand. I'm not going to use my CNC machine because, again, it's just got to fit into these radiuses in here. And so I think just going on my disc sander and, finding a scrap piece and sticking it in here and figuring out how to get it to fit is going to be quicker than trying to cut it out on the CNC machine and then shape it to fit. So I'm going to go cut that out, and I'll show you what it looks like when I get it riveted in. I finished creating this little shim that needs to go inside of here. This was not easy to make. I mean, I shouldn't say it was hard, but it was very frustrating because nothing inside of here is you know, a constant radius. Nothing in here is very flat. So, you know, trying to create this part, which you have to radius the edges on, you know, as best you can to get it to fit, was not easy. Now, I do have it fitting pretty well, and I think the most important thing is that it's flat when it fits in here, which it is. I did drill 3 rivet holes, because what we're supposed to do is put countersunk rivets, 3/32 countersunk rivets, solid rivets that I'm going to insert from the other side, and then you're supposed to countersink and you know, flush rivet these down into a countersunk hole so that it's countersunk on both sides. So I think what I'm going to do is go ahead and I'm probably going to clean these parts up, and I think I'll go ahead and Allodyne them like I always do, and I'll go ahead and rivet these 3 rivets inside of here. And then we'll go ahead and final drill out that center hole to match the 6mm tube that needs to be connected to here. So I'm going to keep working on this. I just want to show you what it looked like. And yeah, I'll get this riveted in. So I got the rivets installed in here for this doubler shim piece. And that installed pretty well. I did drill this out centered on the hole that I already had in there to 6mm. So I think what I'm actually going to do is bolt that onto the end of this this tube here, and kind of use this as a guide when I go to drill the holes in to frame 4 to actually mount this bracket, so that I make sure that it's as close to the right position and there's no tension one way or the other pulling or pushing on this tube lengthwise. So let me go ahead and attach this to the tube here. We'll go ahead and see if we can fit this into the airplane, and I'll start with probably the top holes up here and see if I can get those drilled into frame 4. I got some temporary hardware and was able to attach the tube here to the bracket that we made, and just gently tighten up this nut. Now, I did notice one issue when I tried to fit this in the airplane, and it's something to watch for if you're making this bracket. I didn't think about it too much as I was making it, but now that I have it bolted to it, the bracket has a tendency to adjust itself automatically to what angle the surface and the tube meet here on the end, which the tube is square, but the bracket here, when it was bent, had a tendency to want to curve the tip a little bit, just from all of that force of bending this at this tight radius at the tip here. So what ended up happening is, once I put it in the airplane and I tighten this up onto the tube, the let's see if I can turn it this way, the attach points of this bracket are not parallel to the tube exactly. It's a little bit off. So there's a little bit of an angle here off from the tube. So that when I actually put the tube in place, for example, these bolt attachment points are off of frame 4 slightly. Now, there's a couple ways I can fix this. I could just simply loosen the nut and just tighten it up to the point where the backside of this tube rides against this bracket, which is really all that's required as far as the plans go, is this tube is basically supposed to rest against this bracket, and it, you know, there's no real washers, there's no bearings, there's no anything. It's just the tube rubbing against the aluminum plate, which is, I find, odd compared to all the other things in the airplane where we're putting in bearings and we're being careful about how, you know, friction is happening between points, that we're not worried about it at this end. I was really surprised there wasn't a bearing here to begin with, but anyway, the other thing I could do is I could try and bend these over a little bit more to get this 90 degrees. I don't think I'm going to be able to bend it at all anymore. This, everything in here is too tight. I mean, I probably could bend these lower ones and twist them a little bit, but this upper one, I just don't think I'm going to be able to do it, especially now that I've got that shim plate installed in there. I just don't see it moving. The other thing I could do is I could get the mill and just shave down the side of this bracket here a little bit to square it up. I am thinking of possibly doing that. The other thing I also could do is I could just create a washered slight recess that squares up the end of this tube with this, and actually put a small washer in between here and here to kind of act as a bearing surface that also would square this up with the with the bracket. I'm actually thinking about going that route. And again, all of this is minute changes or minute, you know, modifications. Just to square up that edge. You know, the other thing I could do is just put this the whole side of this thing into, let's say, my disc sander and just sand it down to it's flat. But I am going to start reducing the thickness here of this, you know, eighth inch material. Although I do have, you know, two thicknesses here with the other doubler that's underneath there. So again, I'm not exactly sure I'm going to fix this. I just wanted to point it out. Something to watch for as you're making this bracket is just to double check and make sure that you do have the bolt holes exactly 90 degrees as much as possible to the mounting surface of this control tube. So I'm gonna go play around with this and see if I can find a solution that satisfies my OCD, and we'll go from there. I have this bracket now preliminary fit into place. I've got just Clico's holding it in. I drilled up from underneath the bottom holes here to a 3/32 size. I guess we're putting a number 8 bolt in here, so I'm just going to keep widening these holes until I get to the point where a bolt will fit in. The fit of the tube that goes across here, the elevator control tube, it does fit well. I have a little bit of a gap here. I'm not too worried about it because I'd rather have it a little loose than too tight, because I can always put a small washer or something in there if I needed to. I actually don't think I'm going to need to, but I'll test it out when I get done. I didn't do anything to the face of this at this point. I really wanted to get this bracket installed with the bolts because it keeps changing kind of shape as you put it in here. So I want to make sure it's in a position where it's tightened down before I, you know, even go back and consider doing anything with the face of this. And I'm thinking, honestly, I don't think I'm going to do anything with it at all. I don't like this bracket at all. I just come out and say that. This is one part that I would consider redesigning on this airplane, and it's because of several different factors. The major one is that it's too hard to get it right, and you don't actually end up getting it right. Something's just a little bit off with it. This face is a little off. It's a little bit mispositioned. Maybe it's not quite the right millimeters from the bottom or from here. Maybe it's not bent quite right. There's too many things that can go wrong with a part that doesn't need to be, in my opinion, quite this complicated. And the other issue is, why aren't we putting a bearing in here? I mean, why don't we put a bearing in here if we're putting a bearing in the other side here? It seems to me that, you know, this is a ideal place, especially when you have steel riding on aluminum. Why not just put a bearing in there? And so I would really highly consider redesigning this part to be a, you know, maybe it's three pieces, maybe it's a little bit simpler, but put a bearing in it, have it so it's something that is, you know, can be machined for one thing. I mean, when you have to bend something that's this complex and this difficult to bend, I mean, this 3 millimeter material or eighth inch material is not easy to bend. And so I'm just making some comments about what I'm thinking about in the future, because again, I'm looking at trying to make parts for kits, and it's like, I don't know how to even make that part in a kit. Unless I sent it out to somebody to be, you know, bent in a bending machine with a die, but you know, the expense of that would be huge. So I'm going to keep working on this one and get it in, but I'd hate to have people building a kit and, you know, sending them a blank part like this, say, hey, bend it and fit it in and get it working. Go ahead. Let me know how it turns out. I'd have to send them maybe three parts so they could make sure that they had, had ability to make mistakes and, you know, create scrap metal and hopefully get it right on the third try like I did. But I'm gonna keep working on this, see if I can get some bolts in here, and then we'll start fitting this tube in here. I do want to get to the point where I can paint that tube, actually install it in here, and just bolt this in permanently. I shouldn't need to take this control tube out again, and I'm hoping to get to that point when I start working on the elevator controls that this piece is completely done and I don't have to touch it. Okay, I have this elevator tube installed. I've got the bracket attached now. I've got the actual bolts in there. The installation of bracket actually went pretty well as far as, you know, drilling the holes and getting this installed. Now, I still have an issue where this bracket is not perfectly square with the end of the tube. And in fact, the tube itself really isn't perfectly squared on the end either. And again, I don't like how this works because, you know, this is loose here. But as soon as I turn it here, it gets stuck. It gets stuck because the end of this tube, you know, the part that was welded on, it's not perfect. And so it starts to bind as it come around. So you can get to the point where you've got almost slop in it a little bit, and then you rotate it around and it gets tight. None of this is what I would consider proper as far as, you know, there's just no way to get these two surfaces to meet perfectly and to act as a bearing surface, which is how they are supposed to work, which, again, I don't really care for how this was done. So what I'm going to do is, where this is rubbing, the tube is, I'm going to, you know, maybe sand off the end of the tube a little bit, or I'll possibly just file the bracket on the inside edge a small amount just so there's clearance there and there's not a problem. But then what I'm going to do is I'm going to actually install a small washer in between the end of this tube and this bracket here that I can recess just slightly into the end of the bracket so I can square up the end of the bracket to be square with the end of the tube. And then I'll have a, you know, bearing surface or whatever, you know, between this tube and this aluminum plate. Because what's happening is every time this rubs, it kind of galls inside the aluminum part. I know there's supposed to be grease in here and we're supposed to, you know, grease this to work. But I just don't like this steel tube rubbing directly against the aluminum here. So I'm going to do some more things to try and at least fix what I have here and make this work a little bit better. I'm probably making a bigger deal than I need to. I could just, you know, since there's a lock nut on the other end here, you can just tighten up the lock nut until there's no play in it and it doesn't rub and leave it as that at that. But I'd like to make this a little bit better than what I have right now. I just pulled this bracket off just so I could show you, you know, where mine is rubbing is right on the inside there. So again, I'm just going to file this off a little bit flatter on the inside here and then just see if I can get a washer possibly slightly recessed since it needs to be angled a little bit. And if I could somehow get this in my mill where I can mill a little flat spot here, I think that's what I'm going to do to try and square this up a little bit more with the tube that bolts through here. All right, I have this fixed now satisfactory. So I don't have any grease or anything in this, but this is moving quite smooth and even. What I did end up doing is, I don't know if you can see it there, but I basically took a number 10 washer, and I believe it's an AN960 normal size washer. And what I did is I reamed it out to 6 millimeters so it would fit on the end of the shaft. And then what I did is I put this bracket kind of haphazardly in my mill, and I milled a flat spot into this bracket at the angle that I wanted that washer to sit, so that it's actually somewhat recessed in the back and it sits up flush on the surface on the front side. So it kind of fixed that slight angle that was in this bracket that was causing some of the binding. And now I don't have the end of this tube, the big end of this tube, the 3/4 side, rubbing on top of this bracket that was, you know, since the end of this tube isn't quite square, and even filing it, I couldn't get it quite square. But now it's just riding on that washer that's inside the steel washer, which I think is a better way to do this. And at least it fixed my problem here. But don't be surprised if you see a bracket in my airplane at some point that has been replaced with a bearing in it, because if there was a bearing in here, these surfaces wouldn't have to be exactly parallel, because the spherical bearing will bend into whatever angle or direction you need. So you could bend this bracket, get close enough, and then if you had a bearing installed in here, the only thing you'd have to worry about is the length and the distance and getting it installed properly. You wouldn't have to worry about this exact bend, which is really hard to get accurate when you're bending this massive bracket. I mean, it's just, I don't like this setup, but, you know, it works. And the only other thing I'd comment on is make sure that the nut that you put on back here is a really good lock nut, because I noticed that when I rotated mine and I just have a, you know, free spinning nut on the back of here, that if I push the stick forward, it will tighten it. And then if I pull it back, it stays where it's tightened. And then you push it forward again, it tightens. And I actually got into a situation where I rotated this back and forth a few times and then this was locked into place. Now, obviously, if you have a lock nut under, that's good. It's going to spin with the bracket. It's not going to be, or with this tube, so it's not going to be a problem. But make sure that if that nut starts to wear out, I would definitely replace that, because you could have your elevator here all of a sudden really stiffen up quickly if you had a wash or a nut that was able to spin free and kept tightening itself as you move the stick forward. So, so what am I going to do next? I have no idea. I think what I'm going to do next is I want to get this painted, and there's a couple things that are not done on this, such as there's a hole that has to be drilled in here to pin the ailerons for like rigging. I need to get that hole installed, and then there's also a hole that needs to be installed in here for the stop for the ailerons. So I think that's the only two things that aren't done on this tube. So I think what I'm going to do is go ahead and see if I can get those holes drilled into this tube so that I can get this tube painted, get this installed with this bracket, you know, permanently installed with the lock nuts and everything that should be on there. Everything else I can get to. I can get to the elevator attachment arm that needs to go here. That can be bolted on. All of the aileron stuff can be bolted on after the fact. So I think that's what I'm going to do next is go ahead and get these holes drilled into this bracket here. Let's talk about flight control tubes. That's really what I'm working on next. I did paint the the elevator stick control tube that we were working on the other day. I painted that, so that's ready to be installed. This actually bolts onto that steel tube assembly, swings back and forth, and that's what moves the front push rod for the elevator or horizontal stabilizer in this case. Now, the plans call for three tubes. There's one that goes from the control stick here back to the first bell crank that's in the front of the rear fuselage. There's another tube that goes from that bell crank in the front of the rear fuselage to the bell crank that's in the very end of the rear fuselage by the vertical fin. And then there's another push rod that goes from that bell crank up the vertical fin and attaches to as a horizontal stabilizer. So there's a forward control rod, a rear control rod, and what they call a fin control rod. Now the plans call for 14 millimeter diameter tubing on the, I believe it's the forward and the rear flight control tubes. The one that goes up the fin, they say that you can use 12 millimeter. Now, the other thing they also say is that you can substitute 6061 for the plans that call out for 2024. And that's actually written in the plans by the designer, so that's not an afterthought. The issue is that there really isn't 14 millimeter tubing converted over into inch sizes. We really only have half inch and 5/8. There isn't a 9/16 that I've been able to find. So 9/16 would obviously be much closer to 14 millimeter. But what I decided to do was to just use half inch tubing for all three. And I did use 6061. I'm questioning whether that was the right idea or not. I actually went through the process of trying to figure out, okay, well, you know, which tubes are in tension, which ones are a compression. The fact is that the forward tube here, when you're pulling positive G's, is in a compression situation, whereas the other two tubes are in tension. So the other two tubes, the rear one and the one that goes up the fin, when you're pulling positive G's, are being pulled apart, whereas the tube that goes from the control stick to the first bell crank is in compression. By pulling back on the stick, it's pushing. So if I had to do this again, I think what I would probably do is still stick with half inch tubing, but I likely would use 6061 for the rear tube and the fin tube, and then use 2024 for the forward tube that is in compression when you're pulling G's. So technically that's more likely the tube that would buckle or bend or break or whatever you want to say. The other two tubes that are trying to be pulled apart, they're not going to get damaged. And of course we're not going to be pulling very many negative G's or pushing very many negative G's, so it doesn't, I don't think that's going to be a concern. But that forward tube is the one that technically probably should be a little bit stronger. Now whether or not this is plenty strong enough, I honestly don't know. I just got to thinking about it afterwards, and then of course I went back and forth with the cost. The cost of 6061 is like a third the price of 2024. And the designer kind of got us on the forward tube because the forward tube is just over 36 inches. So you can buy 3 feet of tubing, but now you gotta buy four and cut 11.5 or 11 3/4 of an inch off of it and throw it away. So the other issue I had too is I was concerned about having the two types of tubes in the shop here, 2024 and 6061, and keeping the two separate and making sure I didn't mix them up anyway because they were going to be the same size. So again, I went with all 6061. I went with all half inch. I think it's going to work fine. Again, I'm not really concerned about it, but it's one of those things in the back of my head where I'm like, it is weaker than what the designer intended at 14 millimeters at 6061. a half inch is about 12.4 millimeters. So it is a little bit smaller diameter. So again, I don't know if it's a big deal or not. I'm probably just being a little bit extra cautious. But anyway, I just wanted to point that out, that I am using half inch 35 thousandths tubing for the control tube. So what we're going to do here is I've got all the parts cut out. So I cut these all out on the CNC machine. And what we're doing is we're crimping this tube in a vise. That's what I did here. And it turned out pretty good. I don't see any reason to do anything different than I did. I just stuck it in a very smooth, flat vise and just slowly started to crimp it. And then I cut these shims, which are supposed to go inside the tube. These are 4 millimeters thick. And so as I crimp the tube, I eventually slip this inside of here, which fits right in the middle like that. And crimp the rest of it with that shim in place, so I was able to get get it clamped all the way down. And then what we're basically doing is we're taking one of these and we are riveting it on one on the top, one on the bottom, through the tube and through that shim plate that's in the middle, and then that should give us exactly the distance to fit over our bearings that have been installed in, you know, similar to this, in all the other control bell cranks that we've already installed in the airplane. So these are going to go pretty quick. You just got to cut them to length. You got to, you know, create the shims. You got to drill the holes in here, rivet these on, and just keep going. And all three are made the same. The only one that's different is the one that attaches here to the control stick, which this gets riveted to it. This steel bushing. Of course, I made this earlier on my lathe and mill. And this is where we do get some adjustment here. There is a nut here, and we can turn this in and out and actually adjust the elevator control system. But this gets riveted, just slipped inside the tube and riveted on the front, and the backside gets crimped. And I believe the backside of this one is 90 degrees turned when it gets crimped. But anyway, I'm going to go ahead and work on these control tubes and see if I can just knock these out pretty quickly. I think they're fairly easy to do, so... let me get these done and I'll show you what they look like when I'm ready to install them in the airplane. So this is the first control rod that I finished, and this is the rear control rod. So this is the one that goes from that bell crank that you can see there, and it attaches in the center there and goes all the way to the back of the airplane to the tail. And I'm just going to go ahead and pin that in place with some temporary bolts. And I think what I'm going to do is work on the one that goes from that control rod up here to the stick, and we'll go ahead and get the stick installed here, or not the stick, but at least the elevator tube and the bracket that we made the other day. So we'll work on those two things, and I'll show you what it looks like when I get this next tube completed. So I've got the front rod now completed, this end installed just like the other rear rod that we just did. And then, of course, the front, I had to rivet on this clevis end here that's going to attach to the actual control stick or elevator tube. Now, I did have an issue with these rivets up here in front. This tube is, you know, only a half an inch thick, or a half an inch in outer diameter. And I had some issues getting these pop rivets in because they're actually too long, even though I'm using the smallest AVEX rivets, which are the 1601 0410s. So what I did is I put one rivet in each side, and when I went to put the other one in the other side, of course, they wouldn't go all the way in, which, you know, I tried to even pop one of them by hoping to pull it in as it got shorter, but that didn't really work very well. So what I did is I actually put an 1/8 inch punch in the open hole and used it to just tap down the other side of the, or the back side of the rivet that was in on the other side, just to kind of squish it down enough that I could get a rivet in this side and pop it. I still had to kind of push it down as it got shorter, push it in before it actually popped, but I was able to get all of them in that way, and I think that's fine. I really didn't have any other choice. I actually tried to find shorter rivets, and I couldn't find anything that was a good substitute for these. So again, just take an 1/8 inch punch, stick it in the hole, just tap down to shorten it a little bit, and then you should be able to get a rivet on the other side. But that's what I did. It seemed to work just fine. So I'm going to go ahead and get the elevator tube installed in here so that I can install this control rod then, which is going to go over here And you can see back there, you can actually see I did put that rear tube in place and just pinned it with some temporary hardware. So that's installed. All right, so let me go ahead and get this installed up here so we can actually connect this to something and actually see if we can have some of this working. So this is the elevator control tube that I did get painted. This is what we're gonna install now, and this is what this rod over here is gonna connect to. I did wanna make a couple comments on this though. I did find in the manual where it mentions that when you weld this assembly together, you're supposed to weld the ends onto this tube, and then you're supposed to actually put this tube in a lathe and mill the ends of this perfectly flat on each side. And obviously that would take care of, you know, half the problem that I had with the bracket over here and the alignment of the tube with the bracket itself. And the fact that as I move this back and forth, I could feel it catching in one spot because again, the end of this tube was not perfectly square. And like I said, you know, I fixed it with the washer that I put in there, which I think is a good solution for now. But I did want to comment that I did find in the manual where it did say to stick that in the lathe and actually finish the ends of these after you have the ends welded on. But before you weld the rest of the parts on here so that you can square up the ends perfectly to make it so that it aligns with that bracket properly. Now, again, I don't think this whole bracket and this setup on this side is a good solution. I'm actually going to try and figure out if I can, you know, figure out a alternate solution that would allow you to just weld this up, not worry too much about the ends, use a spherical bearing over here so that, again, the trueness of the ends of that is not critical like it is, you know, right now. So I'm going to keep working on that, but let me get this installed for now because obviously this is what I'm going to use at this point. And let me see if I can get this control rod connected. All right, well, I have the elevator control connected here now. I've got the tube bracket installed, the tube itself is installed. And after I installed this, I had zero resistance on this wiggling it back and forth, and I had no play at all. So I just kept adjusting this nut just a little bit until I got it exactly where it needed to be. And you can see I've got that control rod connected over there, and that's how the elevator system works. The control stick attaches here, and this moves that arm there, which moves the control rod that goes all the way to the back. Now, you probably can't hear it in the video here, but I did notice that the rear control rod in the very, very back of the airplane at frame 12 is just rubbing slightly on the bottom of frame 12, which is a bit odd, but I'll go ahead and take a look at that. I'll probably just have to take a Dremel tool and just, you know, just grind a little bit off that opening there on frame 12, but that's interesting to know that that's happening. I believe that Maz actually mentioned that his was rubbing in the same place also. He mentioned that to me months ago when he was working on his airplane. He got a little bit ahead of where I'm at with the controls and everything, so yeah, I'll take a look at that, but otherwise this is working great. I do have to go and make the fin rod, so that's what I'm going to do next. And I might get to the point where I'm just going to attach the fin rod to the actual horizontal stabilizer and see if we can get the whole thing working, the whole elevator system actually working. So it's looking good right now. Oh, I'm also going to start working on the artificial feel system that's supposed to go in here that, you know, actually provides, there's actually rubber bands that connect to two different spots. So when you pull back on the stick, it wants to center itself. And so I will look at installing that also. I do have all the pieces already for that system, so I'm gonna start working on that also. Well, I thought that control rod was actually rubbing back here somewhere on frame 12, but it turns out it's actually rubbing on the last stiffener right there on the rear fuselage. So the lower stiffener, the first one that's before frame 12, that tube is just slightly rubbing on there. So I'll have to figure out a solution for that, but yeah. Otherwise, that's a little bit harder to fix because I can't really reach in there to get to it, but I'll figure out something. I just wanted to point out that it wasn't actually frame 12, but it was one of the stiffeners. So I have verified that I definitely have a rubbing problem way back there. So count one to the third frame back there. That's, you know, made out of foam with a strip of aluminum on the top. On the bottom, it's rubbing that aileron control rod there, just barely. I mean, it's just touching. And it seems kind of silly to me. It's too bad because, you know, this bell crank here, there's no reason that bell crank couldn't be, you know, quarter inch higher, 6 millimeters higher, and of course then it would clear. And I mean, it's just, I don't know if I can reach back here, but hear that little rub, it's just touching. I certainly don't want to leave it because it's going to rub on the control rod and that frame, and likely the control rod's going to get a worn spot on it, which I don't want. So I got to figure out how to get back in there. I can't reach. I can barely reach back to here. And from the backside, there's a frame there. Can't get through there either. So I think what I'm going to do is take this control rod off. I'm going to try and guess where that is. And I think I'm going to have to take a long piece of pipe and actually just try and put a little dent in the top of that frame so that that tube doesn't rub anymore. There's no other way to get back there. I can't reach back anywhere close to that. And I have no way of getting in there to, you know, actually do anything to fix that frame. My only other option would be is if I wanted to take this bell crank, like I said, and move it up and pop rivet it back on there, but I really don't want to do that either. This foam, you know, it's basically what this is here. You know, it's pretty easy to put a dent in this to dent the aluminum down, which would compress the foam in that one little spot, which, you know, in this case on the center of the bottom of the rear fuselage isn't going to be a big deal. I hate to do it, but I don't see that I have any other choice. So yeah, let me see if I can, and of course hitting that spot right, in the right spot, is probably going to be the most difficult. Swinging a little pipe back there to try and put a dent, but I'm just going to have to do the best I can. I think I'll leave, you know, from this bell crank centered on that hole, I think I can get a pretty good shot to just lift up and drop a pretty heavy piece of pipe, and I have some thick steel pipe here that I can use. So let me give that a shot. I'll let you know how it works out.
I think I was able to successfully get this resolved. It's not rubbing anymore, so the little pipe trick worked. I'm gonna go ahead and get these bearings greased and get some final bolts and nuts installed on the ends of all of the tubes here that connect to the elevator controls. So that's what I'm gonna work on next.
I wrapped the ends of these rods with basically two wraps of blue tape right where the kink is gonna be, and then I mark it on here. What that helps with is that when I'm, you know, clamping it in my vise, which has very sharp edges, it prevents it from, you know, putting some kind of, you know, really deep cut or possible crease in the end here. It leaves a nice smooth finish on the edge of it where it's crimped in the vise. So just wanted to comment on that. The other thing I would comment on too is I made a mistake, but it worked out. That piece that goes inside of here that gets riveted to the ends of these control tubes, I finished one end of the control tube, and then I was working on the other end, and that little piece that's inside there fell inside the tube. Now, luckily, this end here wasn't crimped so tight that I couldn't get it back out, but it took me several tries to maneuver that piece inside of this tube to get it to fall back out of this slot. So just be careful if you're working on these tubes that if you finish one side, you can't get that piece out of the other end anymore. So it was just something that I ran into, I thought I'd comment on. But anyway, I'm gonna go finish this tube up and I'll show you what it looks like when it gets done. What I'm gonna start working on next is the elevator trim lever. This actually mounts on frame 4. And this is one of the coolest things that that John's done for me. This actually is supposed to be a triangle piece that you cut out of steel, and then you're supposed to, on a lathe, cut threads on this and create this shaft, and then you're supposed to weld this to this plate. John actually was able to CNC machine this out of a solid billet piece of steel, which is really cool. But this is actually going to hold this lever on here, and what we're doing is I cut this plate out on my CNC machine, I cleaned it up, I recess some of these holes here on the back, and what's supposed to happen is this is supposed to get mounted on the front here, We're supposed to put solid rivets in here that are supposed to be countersunk on this side, but also countersunk on this side. So again, we're supposed to just flatten both sides flush with the relative pieces of material. Because again, this has to mount on frame four, so it's got to go flush up against the side of frame four. So this goes on here. What we're supposed to do is put some phenolic washers on here to kind of act as a friction friction fit, and then on the top there's supposed to be one of these cone-shaped spring washers. So I actually just bought some 16th inch material and cut these out with a hole saw, and then drilled out the center of them to fit the 5/16 hole size that's here. And so that's supposed to go on there like that. This lever is then supposed to go on here similar to that, and then we're supposed to put another phenolic washer on top of there with a spring washer on top, and then a lock nut. And what this does is this connects to the elevator control arm that's inside the cockpit that we just installed, and it's connected with basically what we'll say the rubber bands. But what happens is you're supposed to be able to reposition this lever backwards or forward, which then puts pressure on the rubber bands between here and the elevator arm, and then there's rubber bands that go from the elevator arm to another connection in front of that on frame three. And you're supposed to just be able to pull this back, which then will change the center pivot point of the elevator stick, so that you can move it aft or forward slightly with pressure from this this lever here. But we do have to have this lever stay in position wherever we put it, and it's got to be able to withstand the constant fluctuation of the elevator, and also the fluctuation of these rubber bands that are connected to it. But you'll get to see that a little bit more when we get to that point. I just wanted to show you what I was going to be working on here next, because I do want to get this steel plate here riveted onto this plate. And then I do want to get this installed onto frame four. And it basically goes where existing rivet holes are. We're going to remove the rivets that are in there. And I think there's bolts that go in these holes, so I think I have to drill these out. But there's existing rivet holes already in frame four that I have put rivets in temporarily when I glued it all together. So we'll drill those out, and then we'll go ahead and oversize the holes for some, I believe it's number 8 bolts. So I'm going to work on this and get this this put together, and I'll show you what it looks like once I start mounting it to frame 4. I did a few more things to prep this trim handle. I went ahead and riveted this steel plate. I also painted this steel plate last night. I just sprayed it just to try and keep it from rusting too much. And I put some countersunk rivets. They're countersunk on the other side. We're going to see if we can get the holes drilled out in frame four where the rivets are currently that we're going to put these bolts in for these three spots. I also put a little bend in this. There's supposed to be a little bend to keep it away from frame four a little bit as it goes vertical. I did cut out and bend this little retainer piece. This is supposed to go on top of everything that's stacked on top of here, and then it basically goes to the corner, goes in that bolt hole on the corner. And I'm not exactly sure what this is supposed to do. I think it's just a extra support because there's a lot of pull on this post here, and I think it's just supposed to give you a little bit of additional support, although I'm not really sure how much 1 millimeter is going to make a difference on steel. But we'll make it anyway. I'm going to Allodyne this, and we'll see if we can get these holes drilled into frame four and see if I can get this piece assembled and installed in the airplane. So you can see there's the rivets that I drilled out for this trim bracket to be installed. I just attached it right now with 1/8 inch clecos. I'm going to go ahead and take those out and drill this out to a number 8 bolt. I think it gets in there, and we'll get the bolts installed and get this bolted on the side of frame 4. So that is the trim lever installed. That actually works pretty well. So it's got that spring washer on there that you just tighten this nut up to a certain amount where you can still move this back and forth easily. But what happens is there's supposed to be rubber bands that basically connect from here to here, and then there's rubber bands that connect from here to another bracket, which I'm going to make right now. And wherever this is pulled to, this will center itself between the tension on the front and the back of those rubber bands attached to the front here and attached to the back here, so you can adjust the trim forward or backward slightly from center. So that should work pretty well. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to cut this bracket out that we need to install here for the other side of the trim setup, And let me go cut that out and we'll drill the holes and get that pop riveted in. I just finished making this part. So this is what attaches to frame three that acts as the other end of our artificial feel for the elevator and our, you know, in conjunction with our trim levers. So I'm gonna go ahead and pop rivet this onto frame three. It took a lot of effort to try and bend this at 90 degrees to fit over the corner of frame three. This is 80 thousandths, so it's fairly thick, but I was able to work it so that I got a pretty decent inside edge there, and it fits fairly flush around the front side of frame three. So I'm gonna go ahead and rivet this in. I'll show you what it looks like when it's done, so you can see exactly where this goes, and you know, compared to the elevator lever and trim lever. So I got this front attachment connected here for the you know, the rubber bands that connect from the elevator control arm. And so I basically right now have all of the elevator system completely done, because we've got the full elevator tube in here, we've got the arm there, we've got all the trim stuff hooked up, and I have all of the rods connected all the way back to the horizontal stabilizer back there. The horizontal stabilizer is not installed, and I haven't put in the final you know, nuts and bolts on the push rods here. And I'm going to save that for a later date, because I'll have to get into all of that when I start to actually, you know, check all of the deflection and all of the settings that need to be done, you know, on the horizontal stabilizer and the elevator and the control stick and everything here. So I'll have to do a bunch of trimming and a bunch of testing at some point. But I did want to show you how this works. So this basically is giving us artificial feel. I went ahead and just put rubber bands around here. There's some other rubber that we're gonna have to put in this place. And then we actually strap this together so that these stay really tight, so that these, you know, rubber bands don't come loose when you pull or push on the stick. But what basically happens here is I can move the elevator back and forth, and you can see the control tubes going back and forth. And then you can see how the rubber bands are being pulled back and forth, and that's basically giving us artificial feel on the stick. But then what happens with the trim lever here is you'll see as I move the trim lever back, it changes the center point of the elevator, and then I push it forward, and you can see it also moves the elevator forward. So there is a certain amount of trim deflection that you can preset with this lever here now that that's connected, which is kind of cool. So I just finished up the installation of the elevator control system. The bell crank back here, I went ahead and greased the bearings and installed the final hardware. And you can see, I think down there, this is no longer rubbing, which is good. I was able to use that pipe in there to just put a little dent in that little cross member across the bottom there. So that seems to have resolved that. So let me go back up here to the front. And you can see I have all the final hardware, greased bearings in that bell crank there, in the rear fuselage. And then up here, I have this just installed with hardware with a temporary nut on the back, because I have to do some adjustment here once we get the horizontal stabilizer installed, which I'm not gonna install right now. I'll wait until a future time when I'm gonna rig everything. We'll install that, we'll check all the deflections of the, you know, stick here, make sure it's not hitting the, or that it's hitting the tank in the right spot, that's hitting the seat here in the right spot, that we've got the correct travel, and we'll have to adjust the center point here at this spot anyway, so I'm not gonna worry about that. I do have to install a lock washer, lock tab washer on there, which I haven't done yet either, but for now I'm gonna call the elevator controls basically complete. There's nothing else here that I have left to finish except for final rigging. So please like the video, subscribe to the channel, and thanks for watching. So I started working on some of the final testing of the stick controls for the elevator, and I'm finding several issues that I gotta deal with, and I thought I'd bring them up in this video since this is part of the elevator controls. So the way this is supposed to be rigged is that this stick is supposed to be in its neutral position 5 degrees forward of center or vertical. And you know, from obviously the fuselage, you know, center line, front to back, so perpendicular to that with 5 degrees forward tilt. Now I'm running into several issues because I can get the 5-degree tilt in the neutral position, but I'm having issues with the trim. Now, I mounted this trim on this plate that mounts to frame 4, and I mounted it where the triangle was not falling off the edges of the bracket here. What I didn't really pay attention to is there is a measurement from this front screw hole to the center of the trim is supposed to be 39 millimeters. So you can see my trim is not centered on frame 4, and it should be closer to center of frame 4, which then the distance from here to the trim handle, or I'm sorry, to the trim pivot point here, and from here to here is always going to be centered, because obviously we've got the same rubber bands on each side, and the trim is supposed to adjust that center point. Well, to get this stick at 5 degrees forward for its neutral position, I have to move the trim almost all the way forward, which means I have no nose down trim. I'd have to leave the trim handle here just to be at the neutral point, and then to still get the same amount of feel forward and backward, pulling forward and forward and reverse on the stick. I don't get the proper trim travel, because I'm assuming I should be able to do a little bit of nose down trim, whereas all my trim is nose up. So what I'm thinking about doing is actually remaking the bracket here that mounts on frame 4, making it a little bit bigger so that I can move that triangle that's mounted behind here over just a little bit. But even right now when I measured it on the plans, I'm only 4 millimeters off. So this stick right now is 4 millimeters further back centered than it should be. I'm not so sure that 4 millimeters is going to make enough of a difference here so that I don't run out of trim when the trim lever is pushed forward. But again, I don't know how much trim down, nose down, I should expect to need, because that would mean I'd have an aft CG. So the other issue, this stick is supposed to have 25 degrees travel backwards and supposed to hit the front of the seat here. I actually got this seat CAD file from Shannon, so I'm pretty confident that this, where it hits back here, is probably at 25 degrees. Just knowing how he does things, it's probably perfect. But when I pull back on my stick, I don't know if you can see around here, it hits the seat belt bracket here on the right side of the stick. It doesn't hit on the other side because this clears the seat belt bracket here, but the seat belt bracket sits up a little bit higher, so it hits the metal frame part before it gets to the seat, and it is off by about that much. When I measure the angle, I don't remember what the angle was, but I think I got 23 degrees or something, or 22 degrees backwards instead of 25. So again, I need to probably notch out the steel on the backside of this just a little bit. It's not going to need much because of the rotation point to get it so that that actually will hit back here at the seat. I'll probably get 25 degrees. Now, the other issue I have, though, is when you push the stick forward, you're supposed to hit this bolt on the fuel tank. And of course, I installed the fuel tank, tried to fit it in here, and I can't get it even close. In other words, it actually hits here on the fuel tank first. I have to push the fuel tank so far forward that it's no longer even sitting in this little spot anymore. It's sitting up on top of frame 2 here in order to get the stick to get 25 or 23 degrees forward travel, which is supposed to have 25 back, 23 forward, before this bolt hits the tank. So I've got other issues here with the tank fitting. In fact, now that I've got all the controls and the cables in it, the other issue I have is that this lower cable here that goes on each side for the steering hits the side of the fuel tank. The pulley here clears and the upper cables clear, but not that cable down there. Now again, that fuel tank was out of a CriCri kit. That's I don't know how many years old, but again, I don't know if there was things done different on the CriCri that maybe those cables didn't exist or were in a different position. I'm not really sure. So I've got to look at that too, but I've got to deal with this trim thing here first, because that's my biggest issue in trying to rig this and then grind off the bottom of this stick so that I can get forward, reverse travel. Everything else is going to be determined by the fuel tank. But I did want to point those things out. So I'm going to go make another bracket here, see if I can move this trim forward. And I think I'm going to move it even forward further than what the plans show in order to make it so that I get the correct amount of trim travel here front to back. It also could be that the stick is not exactly parallel with this trim rod here, which I actually thought that could be the case. But this stick is supposed to be offset a little bit in within the hole here where it sits further forward. You can see it's not centered. It's closer to this side than this side. And it's by design because of the way that this the ailerons go through here. So, I mean, this was made properly. The question is that supposed to be angled backwards a little bit more so that that's a little bit more upright or parallel with the stick, which is not. I can see it's tilted forward just a couple degrees more than the stick is right now at that angle. So, again, lots of geometry things I got to worry about here, and hopefully I can get this all right and figure out how to resolve the issue the easiest way. But, you know, remaking this plate and re-riveting that little triangle support for this isn't a huge deal, so I think I'm going to start there. I did a little bit more research into this, so I actually have compounding problems here. So the bracket here that's welded onto this tube appears to be set up about 3 degrees at angle compared to where the stick ends up mounted in here. So I've got an automatic 3 degree tilt on this even when the stick is up at 90. And then you combine that with the fact that I have this off by about 4 millimeters too far back. That's causing both of my problems. Right now this should be completely vertical, and you can see it's leaning forward. If I go to the 5 degrees forward on the stick, I'm actually 8 degrees forward on that. Okay, so I went ahead to resolve some of these issues, and I just cut out another one of these control arms here for the elevator. It didn't take me all that long to do. I just cut it on the CNC machine. It takes more time to clean it up than it does to cut it out. But you can see I offset the holes on the bottom 3 degrees, so that will fix my misalignment between this and the stick by 3 degrees, which will get me more centered here between these trim parts. Now I did find another issue when I took this off, because you know, you might think, well, why didn't you just widen the hole out? You could have stuck it in there, moved it over 3 degrees, and clamped it in. I actually could have done that. That probably wouldn't have been a proper way to do it. But these two metal brackets here that are welded, the gap between these is actually like 30 thousandths wider than this part is. So this actually fits in here really loose. And so what happens is no matter how hard you tighten the bottom bolt, you'll never get metal to contact metal. There'd always be a gap in between there because these brackets here are steel and they're welded to this pipe. They don't move at all. Now this upper bolt here, that one will compress the two metal pieces together and allow it to clamp down on this, which is how I had it in there before. But the bottom bolt, no matter what, is always going to be loose. So what I did this time around is I created a 30,000 shim that I'm just going to shove down next to it just to get it so that I can tighten the bolts up and have hopefully both the bolts tighten up against this. And it'll prevent it from, you know, possibly getting loose this way or getting wiggly this way, because again, that, you know, there's some play in the bolt holes even. So that's what I'm doing to fix this. So I'm going to go ahead and install this right now. That should take care of that problem. I am going to make another plate for this and move this over the 4 millimeters. Again, that's not that big a deal. All these other parts I can still keep except for this metal piece on the front here, which I'll cut out too. But again, it's not going to take me all that long to get it right, which is what I'm going to attempt to do here. So let me get this installed, and we'll check the stick here and see how close we are to the correct angles. The other thing I did, I don't know if I mentioned this before or not, but I did shave down that steel there. So now the stick actually hits the seat and it hits the seatbelt bracket there at the same time. So I've got a very positive stop there, and at least now I have full travel, which is all that really matters, or is the most important thing. So let me get this reinstalled and I'll show you what it looks like when I check the angles here. All right, I have this all back together now. This is a new plate in the back here. This is a new, I don't know what you call that, bracket support there. This is now between this bolt and this bolt exactly 39 millimeters, so it's made to the plans. The original reason that I made this different to begin with is that my frame 4 is just slightly wider by a few millimeters. You know, part of that's because of the spar box here with the angles that we're using and stuff like that. But that's why I wasn't too concerned about the positioning of this exactly and just getting it to fit. I was thinking that all of this was adjustable through the flight controls. Not realizing that the centering of the stick is adjusted here and the stops are adjusted here. So you really can't have any of it having, you know, any variation. So this is new. I did replace this. This now has a 3 degree angle built into it. And you can see I do have the shim down in there, which worked out really well. I was able to tighten that up really good. So this is at the five degree forward, which is supposed to be the zero position right now, which that is now exactly 5 degrees forward, and I still have quite a bit of forward trim. Obviously, I get here, the rubber bands get a little bit loose, but anyway, it looks like it's the way it should be, and I still have plenty of adjustment this way, so happy with that. I think this is better. I'm glad I fixed it, because now at least I have full trim adjustments here, which is good. So the only thing I was looking at is I noticed that when I get this all the way back here to the stops, which is good, basically this ends up hitting this, or it's really, really close to it. And then if you put it all the way forward 25 degrees, this basically almost hits that other bracket there. So I looked at the plans, and that looks like it's how it's designed to be, at least for that full travel. But you know, if you had forward trim like this and pulled the stick all the way back, you're actually going to hit this as your stop before you hit the seat as your stop, which is kind of weird. But anyway, I'm guessing that the trim would never be nose down like that anyway, is what it amounts to. Anyway, it's all working really well now. I'm happy with it, and I'm glad I adjusted it. So the elevator controls are now finished for real. So thanks for sticking it out, watching the rest of my video. And please like the video, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you in the next video.